Thank you. If you had to choose one cuisine to eat for the rest of your life, what would it be and why? Tanuja Buraka asks me if I've ever gotten annoyed with food. How did you become fat to fit? Please share some tips for budding food vloggers. Why can't you grow like Allah Arjun? Allu Arjun, who's that? Well, I never get annoyed with food. You know, I think every dish that's placed in front of you has been worked on by somebody at the back, by somebody in the kitchen who's put his heart and soul into that dish. Hi folks, we're at an eatery, but we're not here to do a typical gourmet on the road review. I'm here for a Q&A. That's right, I'm here for a Q&A. Firstly, it's been a long time since we've done a Q&A. I think the last one that we did was just as we entered 2020. But in the months since then, I think a lot has changed. The world has changed. Things have changed. Things have changed for us, and I'm sure things have changed for you as well. So I thought it's time that we get into another Q&A. So typically we would shoot the Q&A at home or in the office. But this time I said, let's shoot the Q&A in a restaurant for a few reasons. Firstly, I think you will also be able to see some food since we are shooting at a restaurant. You're not seeing my face all the time. Secondly, I'll get to taste some interesting food. And last but not the least, these are very trying times for restaurants. So I thought let's step out and do our bit to support one of our neighborhood restaurants. The restaurant that we are at today for this Q&A is the Hole in the Wall Cafe, a neighborhood eatery here in Koramangala, Bengaluru. This is an eatery that we featured in an episode of Gourmet on the Road earlier. So if you haven't caught that episode yet, I'm going to place a link right here and also in the description below. I love the vibe of this place. It's an indoor, outdoorsy sort of a place. And they serve great all-day breakfast. And that's what Hole in the Wall Cafe is extremely popular for. In the review that we did earlier, we've done the extensive breakfast here, right from eggs to pancakes to waffles and a whole bunch of other dishes. So do check out that episode at Hole in the Wall Cafe. Well, it's the same everywhere now. You do sanitize and you check your temperature. It's a bungalow that's been converted into a cafe. So there's a certain charm to this place. And I guess in the current scenario, it's a great place to just come and kick back or just let down your guard for some time. I think we're all on edge all the time now. I think every once in a while, you need to step out into a place like this that just allows you to unwind, chill a bit. I can see social distancing markers which says, don't sit here. I think they've reduced the number of tables as well. There's plenty of fresh air that's coming in because this is an open restaurant. Namaste, Nathan.
Hi, how are you?
I'm doing well. How are you doing?
Fine, thanks. Good to see you again.
Good to see you too. So I'm here with Nathan, who along with his wife, Lynn, are the soul of the Hole in the Wall Cafe. Of course, with the team at the back supporting them. So how are things, Nathan?
So far, so good. We've had to obviously move around things to be compatible with the rules that the government has put in. So
okay.
Yeah, so we've reduced the number of tables. We put in different sanitizing points. We've basically tried to stagger the staff as well, cut it down to half the strength. But, okay. But I think what we had a bit of difficulty adjusting to was the slower pace of things.
Oh, okay.
Because we are used to the rush and everything, especially on the weekend. But I mean, we've gotten used to it now. Yeah. I think everyone's gotten used to it.
And what about the food? The food's still pretty much what you serve earlier?
I hope so. You'll be the best judge of that.
Are you still serving all of that?
Yes, the whole menu. We haven't changed anything.
I wish you the very best, Nathan.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to find a table and tuck into some of your all-day breakfast.
All right. Enjoy your meal.
See you. Thanks. I want to begin with the liver on toast. And give me something to drink.
Green mango juice.
Aam panna. Okay, I'll do an aam panna. So now that we've ordered for our first dish here at Hole in the Wall, let's get right into the Q&A. So I have all the questions that you've sent me right here. So I'm going to address as many as I can, and apologies in case I'm not able to address some of your questions. So let's start with the first one. So this one's from Ravi Bhaskar. And he says, do you think the COVID situation will help improve the hygiene standards in restaurants even in the long run? And what are the major changes you've observed in your recent trips to certain restaurants? A related question from Amok Kashyap. He asks, how do you take proper precautions while going to restaurants in the new normal? And a slightly related question is from Sharath Menon, who wants to know how you envision the future of Food Lovers TV, and are there any ideas you want to go ahead with the post-COVID situation? I think the first thing that I want to do is tackle the elephant in the room, because I've also received comments from some of you now and then as to why we are stepping out in the current scenario. And then we'll get to some of these questions. Well, there are a few reasons why we are stepping out. So the first thing is, when this whole COVID situation hit us, I think for the first 2 or 3 months, we were completely under lockdown. And as many of you would have caught on the channel, we went to doing compilation videos. These were shows that we had shot earlier and we made some compilations. So we did top biryanis. I think we did some other, top idlis. I think we already had a top dosa already on the channel. And then we got down to recipe videos. We did recipe videos, of course, involving me and also involving my wife, Sridevi. So we got some recipe videos from her as well. And that's how we kept the show going during lockdown. And then at some point, lockdown opened. So after being indoors for about 2 or 3 months, when we saw that lockdown had been lifted and restaurants were doing takeaways, we stepped out to see what was happening. Of course, when we stepped out, we took all precautions. So I'm always wearing a mask, except for when I'm sitting in a restaurant and eating something. We carry sanitizers, we make sure that we socially distance ourselves in most of the places that we go to. So there's a bunch of precautions that we do take, when we are going out to film. I think that answers, Amog's question. Also, I'm very particular about the kind of restaurants that I've been going to. So I'm not going to every restaurant that I would typically go to, in the pre-COVID days. In the pre-COVID days, I think we were a lot adventurous. We would just step out, we would hear of something, and even if it's a small little, hole in the wall somewhere, we would be there, check out what the space had to offer. But in the current scenario, I think we're very particular about the kind of restaurants that we're going to. So we go to restaurants where we know restaurants that have a track record of taking care of things, even when things were fine, not just now. So those are the sort of restaurants that we're going to. We go to restaurants that are popular. We go to restaurants where we know the people who are running the establishment, etc. Thank you. I have some raw mango juice here, the Aam Panna. Khatta meeta, sweet and tart. Well, I was distracted by my order here of the liver on toast, the chicken liver on toast. One of my must-have dishes when I come here to Hole in the Wall Cafe. And if you want to know what this dish is like, you must definitely check out our Gourmet on the Road episode on Hole in the Wall Cafe. I'm going to place a link to that in the description below. Simple dish, sautéed liver with some onions, salt, pepper, some spring onions, some coriander. There's also some mushrooms that go into this. If you love liver, this is the sort of dish to try at Hole in the Wall Cafe. So when restaurants opened for takeaway, we went in with all precautions. We wanted to take a look at the measures that the restaurants were taking. And when they opened for dine-in, we wanted to similarly take a look at what was happening with restaurants. The measures that the restaurants were taking to ensure that consumers had a safe dining experience. And that's what we covered. And we are still covering in the more recent issues of Gourmet on the Road. And the other aspect to it is that this is what we do. We cover food, we cover restaurants, we cover chefs, we cover glorious dishes like this, and that's work for us. So whilst we did refrain from stepping out for about 2 or 3 months, at some point you have to step out. And also I think we have a duty to support the industry. We have a duty to support restaurants, especially at a time like this. At the end of the day, whether you order in, whether you take away, whether you step out into a restaurant to dine in, I think it all depends on individual comfort levels. All that we're doing is stepping out, taking all precautions, and exploring these dining experiences for ourselves in the new normal. We're not trying to encourage anybody to step out, because I also get a few comments saying you're encouraging people. I think it's all dependent on your comfort level. All that we're doing through Gourmet on the Road and the show that we produce is showcasing what's out there. And that's something that we've been focused on over the last month or so. And the other thing that I'd like to point out here is that whilst this may seem recreational to many of you, of course, this is our work. This is our bread and butter. This is how we earn revenues for ourselves, for people that work with us. This is how we support our livelihoods and keep the show on the road. So that's the reason why we are out here filming Gourmet on the Road. So I hope that answers many of your questions as to why we've been filming Gourmet on the Road even in the current times. So to answer Ravi's question, do I think the COVID situation will help improve hygiene standards in restaurants in the long term? Well, I certainly think it will, because I think restaurants and consumers, you know, woken up to the scheme of things in the new normal, right? So going forward, I think many of these practices that you currently see, whether it's sanitization of hands, social distance tables, employees wearing gloves, masks, I think that is here to stay for at least some time to come. So in terms of changes that we've observed, there are many. So right from temperature checks to sanitization of hands, to ensuring that everybody is wearing a mask, gloves where possible. In fact, restaurants have also taken quite a few measures at the back end to ensure that, for instance, the ingredients that come in are sanitized. In some restaurants, we've seen, especially in the five-star space, where every 30 minutes, the chefs compulsorily have to go and sanitize their hands again. Utensils are being sanitized, are being cleaned after every order. Tables are being sanitized each time a guest leaves the table. So there's a lot that's happening at restaurants to ensure that things are safe. If you want to find out more, I think you should definitely take a look at some of our episodes in the recent past where we've covered this in detail. Sharat Menon wants to know how we envision the future of Food Lovers TV. Are there any ideas you want to go ahead with the post-COVID situation? Well, I think this situation is here to stay for the next few months at least. So I think we will take a call depending on how things are on the ground. I think the one thing that we know for sure is that all travel that we used to do with Gourmet on the Road, I think that's something that will take a backseat definitely in the near to medium term. So I think we will have to be content with exploring more of Bengaluru in the near future, perhaps Karnataka as well, as we go along. That's the one area where things definitely change for Gourmet on the Road for the show. You know, doing justice to my dish and to the Q&A is turning out to be a bit more of a challenge than I had anticipated. But as I'm responding to the questions, I'm so involved in talking to you through the camera that my food's getting cold. But then we'll focus more on this Q&A. As for the food, you see plenty of it in other episodes of Gourmet on the Road as well. So the next question is from Khadar Mohammed, and he asks, he says, in your family, you only show your wife. What about the kids? Where are they? Well, I get asked quite a few questions about the family, and so I thought I must address it now. Well, you know, Food Lovers TV and Gourmet on the Road is me. And as part of what I do, as part of the work that I do, I'm out there in the public domain. And I don't mind that. In fact, I quite enjoy my interactions with all of you. But I think when it comes to family, they have their own lives to live. They have their own areas of work. And they have certain levels of privacy, which I would like to respect, whether it's with my wife or our children. So therefore, when it comes to the show, when it comes to Gourmet on the Road, I think you'll have to make do with watching only me. In fact, recently we involved my wife Shri on the show, and that was when we were in lockdown. And I think it began with that one recipe of the Manjal Kashayam, or the immunity booster, which is something that she makes at home all the time. So I thought we should share it with the world, especially in the current times. And I think you loved that video. I think that video has done over 500,000 views and it's still growing. So I'm going to place a link to that episode in the description below in case you haven't caught it. And so based on the response that we got to Manjul Kashai, people wanted more recipes, more traditional recipes. And so we shared about two or three recipes more after that. You must take a look at all of them. I'm going to place a link to the playlist right below. But once we emerged out of lockdown, Shri too has things that she needs to do, things that she needs to do in terms of work, in terms of her responsibilities. So it becomes difficult to pull her back into doing a recipe episode each time we want to do one. A recipe may typically take only about 30 or 40 minutes when you're just making the dish. But when you're shooting an episode, that takes about 3 or 4 hours. You know, that's the level of production detail that goes into it. And that's the reason why you haven't seen too many of Shri's recipes after those four episodes that we shot during lockdown. So I hope that answers your question with respect to why you don't see too much of my family on the show. Now I'm going to address some questions which talk about the transformation from fat to fit. So there's a question from Ashwin who says, how did you become fat to fit? Sagar asks for me to reveal my intermittent fasting secrets. Kinera Sravani wants to know, how do I maintain my weight? And Vinuta Tilak wants to know if intermittent fasting slows down the aging process. Well, I'll take the last question first. Well, Vinuta, I don't know if it does, but I'm going to place a picture of me before intermittent fasting and after intermittent fasting. I leave it for you to decide if it does slow down the aging process. So in response to your question, Kinera, how do I maintain my weight despite eating all that I eat? I think that answer is found in Sagar's question where he talks about intermittent fasting. So that's something that I do. I have an intermittent fasting schedule that I follow religiously every single day. So in a 24-hour cycle, I'm not eating 16 hours, and that's something that I always do. So I might go in for a review and taste maybe 12, 15 dishes. But once I'm done with that, that's my meal for the day. Of course, when I'm traveling, so let's say we recently did Kozhikode where we shot about 16 odd episodes in about 4 or 5 days. So in situations like that, it becomes very difficult for me to stick to my 18-hour fasting schedule or 16-hour fasting schedule. But otherwise, as far as possible, I try to stick to my intermittent fasting schedule. So on an average, I'm fasting for at least 16 hours in a day. And I think that has helped me to a large extent. When I began intermittent fasting, I think 18 months ago, I went into it slowly. I was looking for, I was, with all the eating that I was doing, I was of course overweight. I was probably about 16 kilos more than what I am today. So I wanted to lose weight, but I wanted to do it in a manner that would become a lifestyle of sorts. That was something that I would integrate, that I could integrate into my lifestyle quite easily. And so when I researched and I looked around, I found that intermittent fasting was something that I thought would help me. Because all that you're trying to do in this is curtail your intake of food only to certain times of the day. And so I got into this. I did a lot of research and I found a couple of videos that really helped me. In fact, I'm going to place a link to that right here in the description below. Do take a look. They worked for me. I don't know if it will work for you too. But the one advice that I do have for you is that before you try anything, always consult your doctor, your medical practitioner. You don't want to get into something that your body is not able to cope with. It's worked for me, it's worked for many others too, but I'm not sure if it works for everybody. That's how I keep my weight in check. I hope that answers your question. As for the journey from fat to fit, if I have to go into the details, I think that would take a good 45 minutes to an hour, and that would be another episode altogether. I know many of you have asked me for that journey, but maybe sometime I will shoot that entire journey from fat to fit at some point in the future. But for now, intermittent fasting is how I typically keep my weight in check. Of course, I'm also very active most of the times. I find it very difficult to sit down in one place. I'm restless by nature, so I'm always walking up and down, I'm pacing. I do a bit of cardio, a bit of walks, light weights, etc. But I think a large part of the reason why I'm able to maintain my weight despite the fact that I'm surrounded by food all the time is intermittent fasting. I love the powdery texture of that chicken liver. Delicious. In fact, the one advice that I can give you, And this goes, you know, back to the last question in terms of eating. When I set out on this Fat to Fit journey, I ensured that I reduced my intake of carbohydrates. So I think in typical Indian thalis, you will always find 50 or 60%, sometimes even 70% of what's on your plate is either rice or roti or paratha, etc. And then we spread the balance 30% amongst proteins, vegetables, etc. When I embarked on this Fat to Fit journey, the first thing that I did was cut down my carbohydrates. So I ensured that I got more protein. And that's something that sticks with me even today. So even today when I'm eating out, I'm consuming more protein, I'm consuming more vegetables, I'm consuming more grains, and I'm consuming carbs in the least amount possible. The body still needs carbs, but I try to keep my carbs under check. So typically if you were to look at my thali would only have 20% rice and the rest of it would be proteins, vegetables, fiber, so on and so forth. And this chicken liver is all about the protein. Of course, it's sitting on toast, but I'm not going to eat most of the toast. There's a question from Rekha, MP, and she says, how often do you get your health checked for the amount of oily food that you quite often are seen eating as part of your work? Well, I do a comprehensive health checkup at least once a year. And so far, things are fine, touch wood. Also, the other aspect is that I'm not always eating everything that's on my plate. You know, my philosophy is to taste more than focus on completing everything that's on my plate. Because at a given review, I'm probably tasting 7, 8, 10. I think the maximum that I've tasted at a single review is about 14 or 15 dishes. Now, if you're doing 14 or 15 dishes, you obviously cannot finish all the food. When I step out, we do have a team. So once we finish the shoot, you know, the team also partakes of the food. But does some food get wasted? Well, the sad truth is, yes, some of it does get wasted. But then that's part of the work that we do. If you're a tea taster and you want to, you know, decipher which blend is fine, you're probably sipping 100 cups of tea to decipher that right blend. You're not going to drink all the 100 cups of tea. And so that's similar to the kind of work that we do. We try and ensure wherever we possible, we cut down on wastage. We try and request for small portions, half portions, but it's not always possible. How do you request for half a masala dosa, etc.? Well, there's a question here from Vidya Sekhar who wants to know, where are you from? How did you get into being a food vlogger, etc.? I've been in this space for a fairly long time. I don't call myself a food vlogger. I think I identify more with the term storyteller because that's what we do. We tell stories in this space, stories on eateries like these, stories on food, stories on dishes, stories on chefs. And I've been in this space for over 25 years now. So that's the background. But if you want to know more specifically about where I've been, where I began, etc., I'm going to place a link to some of our earlier Q&As. You will find all your answers there. So now there are a few questions about whether what we do now is all that we do. So this one is from Rohit Shetty. He says, do you have any other business except being a food blogger? Aditya Vasista asks, are you happy or sad with the money you make from Food Lovers? Do you see it as a source of income for your livelihood or a second fiddle? And Binsu George wants to know, are your videos a paid event from the restaurants that you visit? You know, we believe in a line, and that line is truth in food. So wherever we go, we want to be able to speak for the food independently and speak for the food as it is. I speak for the food as it speaks to my palate, and that's what I convey to you through the camera. Every place that we go, we always pay our bills. So even here, for instance, as I'm shooting this, filming this, before I leave, I will pay my bill at Hole in the Wall Cafe. When I did my extensive review on Hole in the Wall a few months ago, I tasted many dishes. I paid my bill at the end of it all. So that's something that we always believe in. So almost always we pay our bills at the restaurants that we visit. In terms of it being a source of livelihood, yes, this is all that we do. This is not a second fiddle. We are all in. And when we embarked on the Gourmet on the Road journey about a year ago, up until then, you know, we were telling stories in the same space, but stories that were being told by other people, by restaurateurs, by chefs on the Food Lovers channel. And about a year ago, I decided to tell those stories myself, and that's how Gourmet on the Road began with our first series in Mangalore. And it's evolved since then. I was just looking at the number of episodes that we've shot since April. I think we've shot nearly 175 episodes of Gourmet on the Road. So Gourmet on the Road is full time. Gourmet on the Road is all that we do. It's not a second fiddle. In terms of revenue streams, well, our revenue streams for now come mostly from YouTube. Some revenue stream from Facebook. We also get many inquiries for collabs, but we are very particular about collabs because we want to ensure that those collabs are such that there's no conflict of interest. We want to ensure that those collabs are such where we don't have to stray away from our dharma, which is truth in food. So whilst most of our revenues today come from YouTube AdSense, viewership, etc., we hope that in the future we will have more of these collabs which would be interesting, and that would also help augment revenues. So I hope I've answered all those questions there. Prajwal Manjunath wants to know, he says, as far as I know, the way you review the food is just so perfect. Still, I believe your channel is not reaching many viewers. Why is that? Well, I don't know, Prajwal, that's subjective. I think we're doing fairly well. Just to put things in perspective, I think when we began Gourmet on the Road last April, we were at about 5,000 subscribers on YouTube, and today we are touching 300,000 subscribers. So that's a big jump in about 12 or 14 months. In terms of viewership, I think today we do about 10 million views across our various platforms. We have close to 1 million people that follow us, including YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and the other social media channels that we are on. And for us, really, it's not about being in a hurry to get somewhere. Of course, we'd like to add to the number of subscribers that we have. Of course, we want to add viewership with every passing month. But I think more importantly, we want to tell stories that are interesting. More importantly, we want to tell stories that connect interesting spaces like this to you, the viewer. And that's what we are focused on. Our kind of storytelling is also sincere, I like to believe. It's not storytelling that's gimmicky. It's not storytelling that's flashbang. That's not something that we want to do. And sometimes I believe slow and steady is the best way to grow. Santu Ganigar asks about my English. He says, how is your English so good? Can you tell the secret behind that? Well, I think my English is quite all right. I don't think my English is extraordinary. I keep getting compared with many personalities, including the Honorable Mr. Shashi Tharoor, but I think I just speak English to the best of my ability. I used to read a lot, so perhaps that helps to a certain extent. But yes, there's no secret to it really. I think if you want to improve your language, I think it's always nice to read. When you read, you assimilate information, you assimilate words. And I think as you assimilate, you also tend to use them at a subconscious level. And I think that's the only reason that I can think of for the English that I speak. This is a request from Neha. She says, please share some tips for budding food vloggers. Love your videos. Your zeal is highly infectious. Well, Neha, it's very difficult to, you know, share tips, because there are things that work for certain people, you know, some things that work for me, some things may not work for somebody else. But I think the one thing that works for everybody universally is about being true to yourself. I think many a times, you know, you watch another personality and you want to achieve the success that that personality has achieved. And so you try to emulate that personality. I think that's the one thing that you should not do. You should be honest to who you are and project that. I think that's the one tip that I can give for anybody who wants to be, you know, a food vlogger. Be honest to yourself. Be honest to the food that you seek to showcase. As a rule, I always pay my bills wherever I go. That allows me to be honest to the food. That allows me to be honest to my viewers. I think be honest in all that you do. I think that's a great starting point if you want to be a good food vlogger with credibility. This is a question from Jayant Kumar. who asks, what makes you deeply involved in your work and your passion for food? Was it a dream since childhood that you wanted to be a chef? And your hobbies, if any? Well, I was always interested in food. I think even growing up, as a child, I used to get quite a few chores that involved being in the kitchen, whether it was grinding the masala on the stone grinders or maybe cooking a dal when my mom was traveling away, etc. So that's something that I was fond of even growing up. I never wanted to be a chef, and I'm not a chef. Let me just point that out and clarify. I'm not a chef, but I've been in this space for a fairly long time. 25 years, I think, is a long time to spend in any area. And if you've spent that much time and if you've been involved, I think you tend to pick up things. Of course, I love understanding what goes into any dish. So for instance, even if it's a simple liver on toast, I want to know how this dish has been made. I want to know what's gone into it, etc. And so when you're naturally curious or inquisitive, you tend to look for answers. And as you look for answers, you find them, and then that you add to the list of things that you know. And I think that's what comes out when I'm conversing with you about food. Of course, this is something that I'm extremely passionate about, and I'm fortunate that I'm able to convert my passion into a livelihood, you know, for myself, for the people that are with me, for Food Lovers TV. So I think it's the passion that we have for this space that drives us. So even in these difficult times, I think what really gets us out is a sense of purpose, is a sense of wanting to tell those stories, whether it's a takeaway story, whether it's exploring food in a restaurant that's doing all that it can to survive, to take care of its people in these difficult times. I think it's the purpose of telling that story that keeps us highly motivated and charged. In terms of hobbies, well, one of my hobbies is motorcycling. That's something that I look forward to every weekend if possible. I have a couple of motorcycles that I ride. You know, if you want to know more about my hobbies, my motorcycling, do follow us on Instagram. I'm going to place a link to my social media, my Instagram, my Facebook right here. So motorcycling is a hobby. Motorcycling is something that we do. In fact, we also combine motorcycling with food exploration in a series called Gourmet Biker. If you haven't caught that yet, I'm going to place a link to that playlist in the description below. Shri Nayak asks, if you had to choose one cuisine to eat for the rest of your life, what would it be and why? Well, you know, I would find it very difficult to be straitjacketed into eating one cuisine for the rest of my life. I don't have a favorite cuisine, but I do have certain comfort foods, whether it's a prawn biryani, whether it's a liver on toast at this point in time, or whether it's a nice crisp masala dosa sometimes someplace else. So I think it all depends on the time, the mood, and what's out there. But like I always tell, I think my favorite food at any point in time is the food that's in front of me at that point in time, because that's all that I'm focused on. That's all that I'm looking forward to relishing at that point in time. So what's in front of me is my favorite food at that point of time. You know, I get a lot of requests asking me to visit Kolkata, North India, so on and so forth. And that was the whole idea. So since we're based out of Bengaluru, we thought we will begin in the south, and that's how we covered Karnataka to a large extent. We still have to go to North Karnataka. We did some parts of Kerala, we did some parts of Tamil Nadu, we did some parts of Telangana, some parts of Andhra, and the whole idea was to travel across the country and explore interesting food stories. But of course, with the current situation, we don't know, you know, what the future has in store for us, especially with respect to travel. But as and when things do improve, we do intend to get back on the road and explore food within the country, across the four corners of the country, north, east, west, and south, which we've already covered to a large extent, but there's still so much more to be covered. You know, sometimes people ask me also if I'm interested in traveling overseas and exploring food. Well, I'd like to do that, but I believe there's so much in this country for us to explore that I'd like to focus as far as possible on this glorious land that we live in and all the wonderful culinary traditions and customs that have been around for centuries. Krishna BS wants to know whether I've had a serious stomach upset eating at a particular restaurant or eatery. Touchwood, I haven't had any major episode thus far, and I'm hoping I have an unblemished record on that front. But typically what happens is, in most cases, we do a lot of research before we visit a restaurant. Because when we set out to create an episode, there's a lot of time that we spend. So I spend maybe a couple of hours at that establishment shooting, and then we spend a couple of days putting that episode together. So therefore, most of the restaurants that we visit, most of the dishes that we taste are well researched. And so when you do that, I think most of the times you end up going to spaces that are safe, consuming dishes that are safe, because these have been tried and tested by hundreds and thousands of consumers before us. So I haven't had a major issue thus far. And maybe if I have had, it's probably been, you know, long, long time ago, not at least in the Gourmet on the Road series. Soumya Station asks, please share your fitness routine. Do you enjoy eating so much outside food, or you give expressions for the camera? Well, fitness routine, like I said, it's you know, it's a bit of cardio, you know, more freehand, light weights, but it's largely, you know, my fitness routine revolves largely around my diet, which has to do with intermittent fasting. I'm going to place a link to a couple of resource videos in the description. Take a look at it. Do I enjoy eating so much food outside? Of course I do. That's the reason why I do it. I speak for the food as the food speaks to me. So if you watched my episodes, you know that there are certain dishes that I enjoy with greater exuberance than some of the other dishes that I may not have enjoyed it as much. So of course the expressions that I give are reflective of the dishes that I taste. Sneha Jadhav wants to know, what's your educational qualification? Well, Sneha, I'm an MBA in marketing by qualification, but to know more about me, please do look up one of our earlier Q&A videos. You'll find links to them in the video description below. I'm not taking some of the repetitive questions, so sorry about that. Shankar wants to know, show to us our crew members who make this happen, behind the scenes footage. You know, we do put up behind the scenes footage, clips, pictures when we're shooting on the road, etc. You must follow our social media handles on Instagram, Facebook, etc. And some of our crew members are a little shy, like my good friend Nitin here, who's been with me right from the start of Gourmet on the Road as my lead cinematographer. He's also the person who puts all these videos together. Also, you know, this is a journey that we've been on. So we've been filming now for the last 4 years. Ever since we went digital with Food Lovers, we had a magazine earlier. You must take a look at the earlier Q&A just to know where we've been. It'll give you a perspective on us. And then when we went digital, we decided to go with videos. And in the last 3 or 4 years, we've probably produced over 500 short videos on food, wine and dining. Everybody who contributes to Food Lovers TV, who has been with us then and who is with us today, have all added value, have all helped the platform evolve as we've made that journey. And I think that speaks today in the episodes that you watch of Gourmet on the Road on Food Lovers TV. So it's not something that we've been doing now. We've been doing this for many, many years. And I think as you do things over years, you tend to evolve and you tend to fine-tune and you tend to get better at it along the way. Of course, Gourmet on the Road is a new journey, just over a year old. And even with Gourmet on the Road, I think we've evolved from our first episode to our 180th episode that we are probably at now. Well, this is a funny one. This is from Domlapalli Hema. What is the reason behind your head without hair? Why can't you grow like Allah Arjun? Who's Allah Arjun? Huh? Allu Arjun, who's that? All right. Well, I'm going to take that as a compliment, Hema. I used to have hair earlier. I think if you looked at some of my earlier posts or throwback posts, you would have seen that. You know, somewhere along the way, I just think I wanted to go for something new, a new look. I didn't want to spend too much time worrying about my hair, etc. So this is what it is like now. And yeah, so that's what it's all about. Aditya wants to know, what's your future goal set for the channel? Why do you choose to do a food channel, not any other type? Well, this is what I'm very good at. I think this is what we collectively are very good at, because we've been in the food space. I've been in the food space for the last 25 years. The team has had experience in the food space, and that's the reason why we focus on the food space. My other passion is motorcycling, and sometimes people have asked me, why don't you do a moto vlog? Well, I think about it now and then, but you know, we're so busy doing all the work that we do in the food space. I really don't know if we have time to pursue that, but maybe sometime. I'm not sure. Rupa Menon says, do you have an underlying fear of this virus when you travel to these food spaces? Well, of course, we're all worried. I think if I were to say I'm not worried, I would be lying. We're all worried. We're worried for ourselves. We're worried for our team members. We're worried for our families, for our children, etc. But at the same time, I mean, we've been now indoors for about 3 months, 4 months, and this is something that's going to continue for the next few months at least. You know, one will have to step out, one will have to go out for work, and that's something that one will have to handle, that's something that one will have to grapple with. So with all possible precautions that one can take, and that's something that we are definitely doing. But yes, I mean, we do worry about this, but we try and take all precautions. We try and take as many precautions as possible. I had also outlined them at the beginning of this Q&A. Hopefully, things will be fine. I think man can only do that much. Take care, be careful. But I think the rest, we have to leave it to the Almighty. So, I hope that answers your question, Rupa. Tanuja Buraka asks me if I've ever gotten annoyed with food. Well, I never get annoyed with food. You know, I think every dish that's placed in front of you has been worked on by somebody at the back, by somebody in the kitchen who's put his heart and soul into that dish. It may so happen that a particular dish may not agree with your connotation of what that dish should be about, or maybe it does not agree with the way, with your taste buds. But that's got nothing to do with the dish. Of course, there are times when, you know, things go wrong. And maybe there's more salt that's gotten into a dish. Maybe the meat has been cooked dry, etc. But even then, there's some effort that's gone into making that dish. There are probably reasons why that happened. So I don't typically get annoyed with the food. I try and savor food from the perspective of the dish. I try not to bring my biases into. So for example, there may be a certain dish that may not appeal to me too much, but then that dish is appealing to hundreds of people around me. So when I review that particular dish, I've got to place myself in the shoes of those people who are enjoying that dish. You know, there's a saying that goes, one man's food is another man's poison. So a dish that somebody else may like, may not like, I may like, a dish that I may like, you may not like, so on and so forth. So typically, I never get annoyed with food. You know, I have the highest respect for food, and the people who spend time in the kitchen preparing that food and presenting it for our dining pleasure. You know, there are many more questions here, and I think I've addressed only about 60% of the questions, but I think we will conclude this Q&A for today. I hope you enjoyed this Q&A. Thank you for your support over the last 1 year or so. Do help us grow Food Lovers TV. Do invite your friends, your family, your associates to subscribe to the channel. Thank you very much for your likes, your comments. Keep them coming. Do follow us on our social media handles on Instagram, on Facebook, to get to know us a little more than what you see with Gourmet on the Road. And until the next time, stay safe, stay very, very safe, and happy eating. If you'd like to support the work that we do at Food Lovers TV, do consider joining our membership community on YouTube by hitting the join button below or on the homepage. You could pledge a nominal sum and receive special privileges like behind the scenes footage, shoot updates, access to live Q&As, and a lot more. You could support us on a Patreon page as well. For more info, check out the links in the description below. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe, like, share, and leave a comment below. Happy eating!